Afterlife is a Japanese film about a group of dead workers helping other dead people pick their favorite memory from life in order to recreate it on film. It's done to allow the dead to take this memory with them into eternity. But this is not only a film about memories and how hard it would be to choose. It's also a statement and an exploration of the parallels of films and memories. And the result is a brilliant and extremely charming film that itself begins to feel like a memory. Here, I'll be delving into this highly original film from 98 and show you how Koreeda develops this unusual theme. The film mainly takes place in what looks like an old school, where the employees are dead people who's been unable to pick a memory themselves. Until they make a choice, they have to assist others in their decision before recording it on film. The dead are both young and old and differ greatly. There's this one, for example, who doesn't want to choose a memory. While another can't choose because he's never been happy. There are also some who can recall better than others. The character of Mr. Bundo remembers as far back as his first year. While Mr. Watanabe struggles to remember anything at all. The memories they consider are anything from trips to Disneyland, flight, dancing, eating food, or having sex. One central point that Koreeda makes is that all of these memories are, in some sense, subjective constructions and interpretations of past events. It's not simply truth. Not only do people forget, but we tend to polish and idealize the past. What really happened might be different from what our memory of it is. Take this example. A woman remembers the reunion with her fiancé, but only the details that mattered to her. Throughout the film, a parallel between the constructed nature of memories and the character's vanity with regards to their own appearance is established. Here we have Mr. Watanabe, the day before he's going to record his memory. The vanity in this place of limbo is so severe that it causes power outages. And later, we find Isaya mocking Mr. Watanabe for it. Vanity, when it comes to our past, is one reason memories have so much in common with films. That very connection is brought up again here by the character Isaya.
イメージっていうものに変わっていくと思うんですよ。もちろんその実際にあったことですから、それなりの現実味はあると思うんですけど、じゃあ僕が映画作るのと同じ気持ちで、例えば将来について設計した場合に、そのいろんなシチュエーションがあって、それをこう作っていけば、その多分僕の思う記憶とかよりも現実味のある、リアリティのある。
It's as if he's fully accepted that memories do not represent objective reality. And during the shoots, we also notice how the people whose memory they are recreating basically become a film director, constantly making choices. It seems like what looks best here and now matter more than what it really looked like, and that there's an acceptance that their amateur-like recreation won't be perfect. but also that it might not matter that it's not fully truthful, as long as it feels like the memory does. Now, in terms of technique, there are also many elements that highlight this parallel between memories and films. First, the film's genre itself is vague. Kore-eda is known to have used both professional actors and regular people talking about their memories. It results in a film that's both quasi-documentary and fiction. While documentaries strive for a truthful representation of reality, fiction films are honest about creating fake universes. But the truth is that documentaries have fictional aspects to them, while fiction films inevitably always contain slices of reality too. Thanks to some of the technical choices Kore-eda made, I think we could say that Afterlife is more honest about being dishonest than most films are. It seems to have no problem with admitting it's a film, that it's something artificial, just like memories are. As an example, Kore-eda is happy to reveal that this moon was just a prop. Despite having been important to one of the characters earlier. Kore-eda also does nothing to hide jump cuts during the interviews with the dead. Any other filmmaker would have used coverage here, changed the framing, or cut on movement and sound. Then, in the part where they're recording the memories, I get the feeling we're watching some kind of behind-the-scenes footage, rather than a regular drama. It's as if the cameraman is not allowed to disturb the work being done here. In addition, the narrative structure of the film is disjointed, mirroring the fragmented nature of memories. You could perhaps say that Kore-eda is more interested in reminiscing than he is in telling a conventional story. It's also worth considering that film stock and cameras do not perfectly capture a true snapshot of a reality that's out there, and just like the mind and the human eye, cameras, lenses, and film stock are flawed. They have limitations of perspective, depth of field, grain, noise, and so on. And with that in mind, the following becomes even more interesting. These are recordings of the dead people's lives, and is a tool available to those who can't remember much from their past. Notice how dry and lifeless the footage is. It's as if Kore-eda is making a statement on objective reality. Even though it's technically more complete, reality is lifeless and dull when we don't make our own alterations or interpretations when storing memories. Essentially, real life lacks the precision of the artistic, something like a film or a memory. Fittingly, when the character Mochizuki, one of the workers, finally records his chosen memory, the camera points to us as the audience. Moments later, another employee rehearses in front of an empty chair. Inevitably, it invites us as viewers to reflect on what memories we would choose ourselves.